What I mean, sure, Mike. This is all I can say in Chinese. Sorry. A very warm welcome from my side. I'm very happy that I can speak here the second time in a row. It's really a big happening for me, and I'm a very lucky person. Today, I will talk about Angular elements. This is the web component parts of Angular. And I will give you some advanced use cases where you can use it in production. Please, if the translation is not fully correct, I hope you can forgive. So, Angular elements can Angular elements can ship in many different ways, and many different ways lead to many different solutions. And many different solutions mean we have to configure many, many different things. In this talk, I will discuss some strategies that you can use to ship Angular components, web components. This is a quick overview of some versions that you might consider when shipping Angular elements. You have to consider that you can style them from your consumer side, or they encapsulate their styles. You have to consider that they may use change detection or not, and you may consider that they ship third-party libraries or not. Depending on those conditions, you will want to use different bundling strategies to create your web components. My name is Michael Latke. I'm a software consultant and trainer. And the main areas that I focus on are Angular, Ionic, and of course my funny hobby, RxJS, reactive programming. Let's take a quick look at what areas I will talk about. What are the relevant sections that I will explain to you? I will show you that you have to make some decisions based on the way you want to style your components, so CSS. You will have to deal with different versions of how you include zone. And you maybe want to ship different libraries. So these are the sections that I will introduce to you today. If we look at this, we can see how complex it can become if you try to create an Angular element. You have to consider that your element is styled from your consumer, like the application that consumes your web component might want to override the styling of your component, or you want to encapsulate the styling of your web component completely and nobody can touch it. You may use Shadow DOM for this encapsulation. You can use your load your components in different ways. You can lazy load your components, or you can load them eagerly. You can load them pre-compiled as already working web component, or you can turn them into a web component right in your Angular application after you loaded it. You can run different versions of change detection. As I said, you can include ng-zone, zone.js in your application. You can exclude it, or you can also run special versions of zone.js. If you want to know more about Zone.js, we have the expert here. A friend of mine is like the person that knows everything about it, and I'm pretty sure nobody else is that brave and touches this code part. And of course, we can bundle it with different strategies. So let's start to improve the developer experience when you create and start to test your components. I will show you a very, very bad example, and we can later on improve this example. So, consider making a small change to your component would take you the full build cycle. What I mean with full build cycle is this. If I want to test a simple change in my component, I first have to build the component. Then I can use this bundle that I created, include it in the Angular application, and serve this Angular application. The thing that you can see here, the bad thing is, everything happens sequentially, one thing after another. This takes a long time to test your components. So the first thing I will suggest is this. First, I will talk about the consumer side, so the part that consumes a web component. And for the consumer side, I suggest you to install a small library that is called AngularExtensions/elements. If you install it, it will basically enable you to lazy load your components by just placing this small directive there. Star x lazy element. And if you put this directive there, it will automatically lazy load the bundle that you need to use this web component. The second thing that I encourage you to do is set up a local HTTP proxy. Three things involved: package.json, angular.json, and tsconfig. This is like the key to make it parallel. First, you need to set up a port, so you specify that your Angular application is not served on the default port, but here served on the port 4242. And then you say, on the consumer side, I want to specify a proxy config. And what this proxy config is doing is, whenever I want to fetch something from an URL that starts with provider/, I redirect this request to the port 4242. And this enables me basically to serve both projects in parallel. So when I make change to one of those two projects, I can do it independent from each other. I can change my web component without running the full build cycle and process everything sequentially. The next thing is tooling from the provider side, and this is already solved. So if we set up a web component, we can build and serve it completely independently. So here, we don't need anything already. The final product looks like this. And I guess it's very obvious what we did. Instead of having this sequential queue, where I first have to run the build of my component, and then I have to run the build of my Angular application, now I can do it in parallel. And it saves a lot of time and, of course, a lot of pain that you will experience when you try to develop it. The second thing that I will talk about is styling strategies. You have to consider, if you ship a web component, you have many different targets or consumers that will consume this component. Maybe it is an Angular application, maybe it is a vanilla JavaScript application. Maybe your consumer wants to override the style. So think about material design, this library, and think about you include some material design form control in your web component. Then, of course, this component should have exactly the same style as your consumer, as the part that uses the web component. In other cases, you want to ship it completely self-contained, completely independent from your consumer. So what if your consumer wants to decide to change the styling of your web component? We have two different versions that I suggest. We have a self-styled and a consumer-styled version. As I said, the self-styled version ships their own CSS. It's sealed, it's like sealed over the shadow DOM. And the other version is the consumer-styled version of web components. And they mostly don't ship own CSS. And you can control them from the parent side. So what is the styling strategy for a consumer-styled web component? I basically ignore everything that I would ship in the provider side. So options for styling in my provider side are ignored, are stripped out, and you only focus on the consumer. I hope the translation is right. The other thing that you have to consider is styling strategies for self-styled web components. In this case, the CSS of your consumer doesn't matter at all. What you want to do is, you want to take the styling that is part of your component and use the view encapsulation shadow DOM to basically encapsulate or provide this styling over the shadow root of your later on created HTML tag. So what we realize is we have to make a decision to either include CSS or exclude CSS. And as you can imagine, if you want to ship a web component in two different versions, you have to make this change, build it, and then you have to make another change and build it. So it's not really trivial to ship both versions. The next thing that I want to talk about is change detection. Change detection can happen in many different ways for many different reasons. The normal version is you ship Zone.js with your web component, and it is the normal change detection that Angular also uses, and this is very good for standalone web components. If you use them in an Angular application, you have two variants. You can either ship them completely zone-less, so no change detection over Zone.js, or you want to inject the parent zone into your web component, because otherwise change detection will not work properly because you have two different instances of Zone.js. So this is stuff that you need to consider. So what if change detection is decided by your consumer. What if your consumer wants to say, I decide if you run zone less or zone full? Here we see the different versions that we can use. On the one hand, we can ship web components zone full. As I said, we can do this two ways. We can include Zone.js directly in the bundle, or we can inject the zone from the parent consumer application. If we go zone less, we also have two options. We can either don't ship zone at all, or we can again inject or control it from the parent. So let's talk about zone full change detection. The default variant is you ship zone with your web component. This is the easiest variant that you can use because it's already done. If you open up Polyfill TS, you will see this import, and this means Zone.js is included in your web component. The other version is your consumer can inject zone. What do we need to do for this? On our consumer side, we need to make a small hack. We need an instance of zone. Here I basically inject ng-zone. And what I then do is I put the instance of zone on my window object. It's a very dirty hack to later on in the provider side get access to this instance of zone and use it in the dependency injection of my provider side. And then I have the same instance of zone that my consumer owns also in my web component. Zone-less change detection is the next part. And if we go with zone-less change detection, we can do two different things. First of all, we can check noob zone. So noob zone basically means that I fake the zone object and change detection is not running over ng-zone. We have to provide this string noob. The other part is I could inject from my parent. I will do exactly the same as before. In my consumer side, I will attach something to my global window object. And in my provider side, I again consume it from the window object. In this case, the difference is that I have no real zone instance present. Again, we need to make a decision. So somewhere in our code, we need to make all those dirty hacks, all those small decisions to ship both versions of the same web component for different consumers. And again, this is hard, tricky, and makes your code base messy. Loading strategies. Another part that you will use when you use web components. Here we have three versions, and the first one is I lazy load pre-compiled web components. What does pre-compiled web components and lazy loading mean? In my provider side, this is maybe a familiar snippet of code for you, I call create custom element. I provide the class and the tag name, and then I basically wrap my Angular component with a snippet of code that turns it into a real web component. And this snippet of code happens in my provider bundle. This is what I call pre-compiled web components. I decide if I want to do it, or if I want to pre-compile it or not, then I generate the web component and I lazily load this web component later on in my consumer. The other version is uncompiled web components, and this is a, let's say, very alternative way of using it. What does it mean? The line of code create elements is now not executed in your provider bundle, but in your consumer bundle. For those of you who already use web components, you might realize that you basically lose every cool feature that Elements provides you or a web component provides you. A web component is a self-contained universe. And if you do this in your consumer side, you lose all of those cool encapsulations that web components by design provides you. So why do I mention this version? It's a really cool trick to have completely dynamic HTML in your Angular application. So I don't use this approach to get elements or web components. I use this approach to have completely dynamic HTML. If you want to know more about it, Google Talks from Yuri, he will give you a very good overview how to implement it. Yuri Strumpflohner is the full Twitter name, I guess. And how does it look? As you can see, I don't have a provider bundle anymore. So I lazy load a part of my normal Angular application. I pull out the components and turn them into web components just to have way more flexibility when working with dynamic DOM. And the last thing, the thing that I would not recommend you is providing my component statically in my consumer bundle. This is the worst thing you can do. Stephen already told us in the previous talk, lazy load everything you can. So statically providing an element in your bundle is definitely something that you should not do. But there are edge cases where this is a need, so therefore I present this edge case. And what it does, it is pretty simple. I create my web component, I statically include it in my Angular application, and then I build my Angular application. This is basically the wrong approach that I showed you at the very beginning, where we run through the build steps sequentially. Very good. So we can have pre-compiled and uncompiled, and the way that I would recommend you use your Angular elements is the lazy loaded pre-compiled version. So let's recap what we heard so far. If we take a look at the big picture, we see how many different files we have to touch. We see how many different decisions we need to make to set up all the different versions from one single code base. If you can imagine setting up two, three variants of your web component would end up in a project that contains multiple different versions of main TS, multiple different versions of polyfill TS, a lot of hacky code in your consumer side, and a lot of hacky code in your provider side. A lot of tricks that you need to know and implement in a very fiddly way. So what I did is I restructured the whole process. And I will introduce to you something that I call Angular Element Variants. Let's flip it upside down and talk about Angular element variants. You remember all those decisions through the whole build process? So what I did is I implemented a new layer of abstraction. I call it Angular element variants. It's an interface and configuration option for you where you can put every single decision that you need to make at one place. And every other part that is involved in this decision will basically reference to this one single point. All the bundling is referenced to this stuff from your provider side, but also all these decisions you need to know and make if you want to consume this Angular element is also referenced in this one single file. So how does an Angular element variant look like? It contains four blocks. I extended the bundler a little bit for this, so I have custom bundling. The main part is the variant file that I will show you. And then I also provide two different snippets of code, services that help you to deal with all the problems you have on the consumer side and all the problems you have in the provider side. Let me give you more idea what I mean. So what is the bundler doing? Think about following scenario. You want to ship Angular elements. You want to run change detection manually, so you don't want to include Zone.js. And you want to use the support ECMAScript version 5. At the moment, this is not possible, because you will always include a legacy part of ng-zone in your ES5 version. Even if you comment out the Zone.js import in your polyfill TS, you still will include the legacy part of it in your ES5 polyfills version. So what I do is I open all the and I look, you want to ship it for ES5 or not? And I basically include all the parts based on your decision. So I rewrote this manual, this step of bundling for you. You don't need to know all the details. It's hidden in the background as a custom bundling. The second thing, and this is the heart of Angular elements, is the variant interface. And this interface provides you in a very easy to understand and typed way, a way how you can configure the variant you want to use. As you can see, we can decide if I want to ship my zone or not, if I want to use polyfills or not, if I want to use ECMAScript version 2015 or 5, and so on and so forth. So you can make all the decisions in a fully typed JavaScript object. The other parts that I ship is a consumer utils bundle that helps you to set up all the stuff in your consumer, and you basically need to call just a single line of code here to do all the tricky configurations in your consumer side. And the same thing also for your provider side. All the tricky small configurations that you would need to do, multiple versions of main.js, multiple versions of polyfill.js, they are all gone, and you just call this one single line in your provider side to set everything up. As a last part of my talk, I will do a small demonstration how I will use it and how it looks to basically ship multiple versions of the same Angular element. Hopefully the demo gods are with me. So I serve this application here, and I have three different web components. I have a very, very simple web component that is just a headline. I have a little bit more complex web component that is basically a material form control that I can use and type in. And the third thing, the third component is a third-party library that uses material form to create, based on a config object, a completely different, a completely dynamic form. So it's a third-party library that uses another third-party library. On the other side, I have this element served on the port 4242, and just to prove that it is really served on this port, I quickly change the DOM. I write here mat web component. Oh, sorry, just web component. And if I do this, you see it shows up here, so I definitely serve it. Let me now go here and give you some clue what I can do now. Where do I place my variant? So if I open up the project, basically, I don't know why it's not open yet. Give me a second. And I open up my project, I see that I introduced a new folder here under environments that is called variants. And if I open up the variants folder, you see I have all those variant files that specify the different variations of my component. One variation is styled by Angular, another variation is vanilla styled, standalone, zone full, zone less, so I can have many different variations. If I open up one of them and I go here, let me remove the magnifying glass, you see this is the configuration that I use. Here I use style encapsulation shadow DOM. If I go to my project and I put the focus on the element here, you see it's blue, even if my consumer app is yellow. If I now change the configuration to style encapsulation none, which means I want to have my provider styling my consumer styling my provider, and I refresh the page, we see that when my elements lazy load and I focus the text box again, it is yellow. A proof that I now don't encapsulate it with shadow DOM and override it from my consumer side. As you might realize, this means I automatically opened up the web component and stripped out all the styles that I provided there. I didn't do it manually, it happened automatically in the background. And I can also show you, if I open up my small helper, that I inject CSS from the outside. This is basically automatically generated from my code base. If I switch back to the normal implementation that I had before, and I go back to Shadow DOM and reload my project, and I open it up now, that style CSS is now encapsulated in this green box. So you really see how you configured your Angular element. Very cool to debug your application. Let me give you another small demo of what I can do. So you might not know it, but if you include Zone.js in your Angular element and you use it inside of an Angular application, it is not working properly. Change detection is not working. Not a lot of people know this, and I can prove that it is not working. So if I go to the first one and I type in, you see there is some animation happening. As you can see, when I focus and defocus, it jumps, it moves. Now I go to my third party component and I click it, you will realize that there is something wrong. I click it now and I type. Can you see it? It's not animating properly. Change detection is not triggered. This is the reason because I have two different instances of Zone.js. So everybody of you that uses Zone web components in production definitely needs to implement the hack that I demonstrated you to make it work properly. So now I'll show you how to fix it. I go into my configuration file without touching anything else of my project, and I change the configuration for zone handling here from shipped to injected, which means the consumer will now inject his own instance of zone into my web component. If I bundle it again and reload the page, so just before we refresh the page, as you can see, Zone is shipped with my Angular element. It's included in the bundle, in my element bundle. If I now refresh the page and I again open up this debugging tool, so I use these small full boxes to debug my bundling, and I open it up, you can see that now Zone is injected from my consumer into the provider. You really see what's happening in the background. I didn't touch anything else but the configuration file. Let's see if it's working or not. I go here. This was working already. So as you can see, I have this very nice animation when starting to focus and defocusing it. And now I will click on the broken version. And as you can see, the animation is finally working here properly. So I will I definitely use my consumer version of Zone. And as you also maybe realized, I did nothing else but just going into my variants config and change this one single string from shipped to injected. The normal process would make you go and open up different files, comment out some imports, doing this, doing that. And as you can imagine, if you have to maintain the code base and build and ship these two versions for Zone, you can not really maintain it because you cannot check in the version where Zone.js is imported, and you can also not check in the version where Zone.js is not imported. Just that you know what it means for you to maintain multiple versions. I could do more demos, but other people also wanna speak here, so let me end my presentation. One second. Thanks. Thanks for your time. Thanks that you spend your time with me, and I hope it was interesting for you, and you can use it in your real-life projects and fix all your problems that you now know that you have, that I'm pretty sure you didn't know before. Thanks again.